is the second opinion piece by the founder of WikiLeaks published by the Washington Post this month. And in it, Assange writes, quote, when the director of the CIA, an unelected public servant, publicly demonizes a publisher such as WikiLeaks as a fraud, coward, and enemy, it puts all journalists on notice, or should. Pompeo's next talking point, unsupported by fact, that WikiLeaks is a non-state hostile intelligence service, is a dagger aimed at Americans' constitutional right to receive honest information about their government. This is a direct response to CIA Director Mike Pompeo's policy speech here in Washington at the Center for Strategic and International Studies, where he called Assange and WikiLeaks a hostile intelligence service aligned with Russia. And in that same speech, Director Pompeo seemed to anticipate the WikiLeaks defense.
Assange claims to harbor an overwhelming admiration for both America and the idea of America. But I assure you, this man knows nothing of America and our ideals.
And intelligence officials say WikiLeaks is actively recruiting to infiltrate the CIA and other agencies to steal U.S. government secrets, Chen.
All right, so Catherine, what do we know about potential charges actually being filed against Assange?
Well, the Attorney General says it's a priority to bring charges in leak investigations, and he specifically singled out the recent theft of CIA records, which exposed some of the agency's most sensitive cyber tools. They were posted online by WikiLeaks under the name Vault 7. A cybersecurity specialist told Fox News that WikiLeaks has found a way to back-channel this kind of information through the dark web, becoming a bulletproof distribution host. But the most recent leaks, also to the benefit of Russia, has altered the dynamic.
What's changed, I think, is our understanding that WikiLeaks and Julian Assange are being orchestrated by the Kremlin to distribute information that could be used as propaganda to undermine trust and confidence in the institutions of the United States of America.
The American lawyer for Julian Assange says that he has not been contacted by the Justice Department, and he also emphasized a key line that we saw in this Washington Post piece by Julian Assange. They say WikiLeaks is a news organization, and cultivating sources is a protected activity. The Justice Department, it seems, sees it quite differently, Shannon.
Yes, they do. Mm-hmm. Catherine Herridge, thank you for keeping us
updated.
And welcome back to Hannity. So Democratic crybabies all across the country, they're having a very hard time accepting the crushing defeat to President-elect Donald Trump, and they're now trying to blame their loss on Russian interference. Now, earlier today on my radio show, I interviewed WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange and asked him about this and much more. Take a listen.
Our source is not the Russian government.
So in other words, let me be clear. Russia did not give you the Podesta documents or anything from the DNC.
That's correct.
Can you confirm whether or not you have information involving hacked info from the RNC?
We received about 3 pages of information to do with the RNC and Trump. But it was already public somewhere else.
Without revealing your sources, would it be fair to say that the information as it relates to WikiLeaks and John Podesta's emails came from within the United States to you?
We have said it has not come from a state party. We know where it came from originally, of course. It's John Podesta, it's from the DNC, etc. There's been no claim that has been held up, it's not even maintained anymore, that any of the information has been modified or is fake.
So you can't confirm or deny if this information came from within the United States?
We're unhappy that we felt that we needed to even say that it wasn't a state party. Normally we say nothing at all, but we have a conflict of interest. We have an excellent reputation, a strong interest in protecting our sources, and so never saying anything about them, never ruling anyone in or anyone out. We sometimes do it. We don't like to do it. We have another interest, which is maximizing the impact of our publications.
Let me ask you this, then.
So here, in order to prevent a distraction attack against our publications, we've had to come out and say, no, it's not a state party. Stop trying to distract in that way. Pay attention to the content of the publication.
So in other words, when you say state party, it wasn't another state like Russia or some other country.
Correct.
How secure is America's agencies, American government, America's secrets?
Everything is almost completely insecure now. The computer systems have become so complex that it is not possible to understand all the parts, let alone secure them. It is just impossible.
So, and that goes for individuals as well as a government?
It goes for all of us.
Let me ask you about the Craig Murray, former British ambassador to Uzbekistan, an associate of yours. He was quoted in the Daily Mail that he flew to Washington, D.C. for the emails. He claimed he had a clandestine handoff in a wooded area near American University with one of the email sources. And the leaker's motivation was, quote, disgust at the corruption of the Clinton Foundation and the tilting of the primary election playing field against Bernie Sanders. And he said the source had legal access to the information. The documents came from inside leaks, not from hacks.
Yeah, we don't comment on sourcing. Craig Murray is a former UK ambassador. He is a friend of mine. He is not authorized to speak on behalf of WikiLeaks.
Are you angry that he gave this interview?
I just don't want to go anywhere near that.
Okay. Is it much more likely that would have happened versus the Russians?
I don't want to be drawn on this.
Okay.
We have to protect our sources.
All right, here now with reaction, the co-host of the hit show The Five, Eric Bolling, Kimberly Guilfoyle. You know, it's amazing. They ignored the collusion between the media and, of course, the Clinton camp, and they ignored that. The racism, misogyny, sexism, anti-Semitism of the DNC, the only thing that matters here, if it hurts Donald Trump, let's make it up, even though he denies it, and there's no evidence that proves it.
Liberals, anti-Trumpers, remember, Hillary Clinton didn't want to come out and concede the election that night. Allegedly, reports say she got very violent with Podesta and Robbie Mook. Okay, it was their fault first. Then it became voter fraud. So when we had to go through this charade, song and dance of recounts, that didn't work out. Then it became it's the Russians' fault. The Russians affected the election. It's none of the above. They had a flawed candidate. Hillary Clinton is the worst candidate, not necessarily the worst human being, but the worst candidate to run for president in my lifetime. The Russians didn't make her say come up with deplorables, and it wasn't Donald Trump who made Obamacare premiums skyrocket, double in some cases, the week of the election.
Julian Assange was very clear it wasn't the Russians, and no state whatsoever. There was a report earlier today, DailyMail.com, about Craig Murray, mm-hmm. WikiLeaks, former ambassador to Uzbekistan, claiming he had a meeting, a clandestine handoff in a wooded area near American University with the source, and that the source was within the Clinton campaign, and they were disgusted at the corruption of the Clinton Foundation and the tilting of the primary election field against Bernie Sanders, and that this source had legal access to those emails.
Right, so pretty compelling, like, factual narrative there to say exactly what the genesis of this was. But you have to understand, that doesn't comport with what they want to tell the American people is the story. They want to be able to try to undermine the presidency to come of Donald Trump, the movement that put him in, and to discount the flawed nature of their candidate who had no regard for the law for the American people and concealed and destroyed evidence and cost lives to be lost in Benghazi. The real story.
We know the CIA did politicize what happened in Benghazi because they advanced the false narrative about a YouTube video spontaneous demonstration, and the spontaneous demonstrators just happen to have mortars and RPGs in their back pocket. Are either of you worried at all about the electors that are being intimidated?
I'm not worried about the electors. I'm concerned that the CIA wouldn't put someone forward. There's supposed to be a House Intel Committee meeting tomorrow behind closed doors, not off the record, on the record, but in private, and the CIA wouldn't put an intel agent.
Maybe they think the evidence is flimsy and weak.
Or since they made the original claim that the Russians affected the outcome of the election, since then they've come up with more evidence proving that maybe they didn't, or they were wrong in the first place.
Yeah,
at the very least, show up and let the House Intel Committee
agreed.
Find out.
That's what oversight's supposed to be.
Well, my sources about in the CIA that I spoke to about this told me there's a divide even within the CIA, that many of the old guard, the actual operatives, the people doing the hard work in and out, are in, I guess, basically in conflict with some of the younger analyst types who are more politically leaned toward Hillary Clinton, yeah. And that's really what has gone on here, and it shouldn't
right.
be that way. But so far, you're not hearing specific evidence, credible evidence, to say that the Russians had anything to do with hacking or, in fact, affecting any voter fraud in the outcome of the United States presidential election.
All right. Thanks, both of you, for sticking around late as you do. We appreciate you always being here. Thank you.
Thanks, John.
And welcome back to Hannity. So during my exclusive sit-down interview with Julian Assange at the Ecuadorian Embassy in London, I asked him specifically about the FBI and DHS report on 2016 and the election hacking. Let's take a look.
The FBI Department of Homeland Security
this goes to the 29th of December this past year, released a joint report detailing how federal investigations and investigators linked the Russian government to the hacks of the Democratic Party organization. And they gave a 13-page memo. I'm sure you've read it.
I have read it in detail.
At this point, okay. It's supposedly they give technical details regarding tools and some of the infrastructure of the Russian civilian and military intelligence, but they don't give any proof positive.
They give the five-page description of some of the tools that they allege that the Russian state uses. The rest is just fairly boring security recommendations. On the top, there is a disclaimer saying nothing.
I was going to ask you about that.
Guarantee that any of this information is accurate.
Right. It's a guess.
So if you, it's just you'll look in the. I used to be a computer security expert. That was my job. This is a bad report, and you look in the rest of the computer security community, you'll see dozens of other computer security experts in the United States, absolutely not affiliated with
Russia. Isn't it contradicted, though, by our own director of intelligence, national intelligence?
James Clapper.
That's James Clapper.
Well, there's nothing in that report that says that any information was given to us. Nothing. What they have is what they call indicators. So a way to recognize if these tools, these alleged Russian tools, have been used on your system. Mm-hmm. Okay. So in response to that, some engineer at one of the US electricity companies found this signature on one of their laptops. Okay, so then this was analyzed by a wide range of US computer security experts. I've read those reports in detail. And it's discovered this is a commercially available tool produced by Ukraine. So it's straight out of the bat, we either have a deliberate attempt to mislead or thoroughly incompetent work. Straight out of the bat. So that story about the laptop at the power generation center, that was picked up by the Washington Post and the administration, pushed everywhere, that here's the Russians infiltrating the electricity grid, and it was completely bogus.
That was bogus. But there's another side of this, which is, I think, pretty fascinating, and that is that Hillary Rodham Clinton had a private server at a mom-and-pop shop in a bathroom closet that I would argue, and other lawyers would make arguments, that it was illegal for her to have. From what we understand, the Podesta emails were hacked through a phishing scheme where it said, click on this, give us your information, and he did so. So we made it.
Well, there's a number of hacks of the DNC and Podesta based on the publicly available information. This is not something coming from our sources. We published, as part of our policy of full disclosure, not interfering with the material, we published the several Podesta emails, which shows Podesta responding to a phishing email. Now, how did they respond? Podesta gave out that his password was the word password. Mm-hmm. His own staff said, this email that you've received, this is totally legitimate. So this is something a 14-year-old kid, could have hacked
based on
Podesta that way. In relation to computer security and Hillary Clinton's security, those Secretary of State emails, if you read closely FBI reports and the emails that we released related to Hillary Clinton, you'll see whom Aberdeen had access to them, a variety of technicians at this very small IT company had access to them. They were shipped through the post in a laptop. She had over a dozen different devices keyed in to have access to them, her iPad, etc. She made almost no attempt to keep them secure from states. Now, was she trying to keep them secure from the Republicans? Well, probably. But in terms of foreign states, almost no attempt.
The reason we have these laws, though, are for transparency, and she wanted to avoid congressional oversight.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's absolutely my interpretation as well. Now, WikiLeaks has been a very strong proponent of the Freedom of Information Act. This is probably actually, if you think about it, probably against our interests as a publisher. But we believe that people have the right to know true information about what the government is doing. Now, the Freedom of Information Act has been subverted. We published Sarah Palin's emails. Why? Because she had, when she was governor of Alaska, she maintained an account that was being used, intentionally or not, to evade the Alaskan Freedom of Information Act. So we published them back in 2008.